We're going to go down into the next few verses, which is verse 11 and verse 12. Okay, so actually we're going to finish up verse 10. Verse 10 said, but these speak evil of those things which they know not, but what they know naturally as brute beasts, in those things they corrupt themselves. Let me also read the Amplified Bible. But these men revile, scoff, and sneer at anything that they do not happen to be acquainted with and do not understand. And whatever they do understand physically, that which they know by mere instinct, like irrational beasts, by these they corrupt themselves and are destroyed, or they perish. Okay. There's another reference that also I said references the same thing that Jude says here. And that reference is 2 Peter 2, verse 12. We read that last week, but I'm going to read it again, because it says it just like Jude says it. So I'm going to read that verse, and then we'll talk about it. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 12 says, but these, as natural brute beasts, made to be taken and destroyed, speak evil of the things that they understand not, and shall utterly perish in their own corruption. And the Amplified Bible says it like this, but these people, like unreasoning beasts, mere creatures of instinct, born only to be captured and destroyed, railing at things of which they are ignorant, they shall utterly perish in their own corruption. In their destroying, they shall surely be destroyed. So both Jude and Peter are saying that these ungodly men, these false prophets, these uncertain men, that were in the church at that time trying to deceive others, they were speaking evil. They were blaspheming what they didn't understand. And remember that to blaspheme means to slander or to speak evil of something that's sacred. So these people are speaking evil of spiritual things because of their ignorance. What they did understand and was motivated by, what Peter and Jude are saying is that they're literally like animals. It's instinctive, okay? It seems kind of harsh. The words that Peter and Jude are using here seems a little bit harsh, doesn't it? It seems like they're insulting these men. But understand what instinctively means here. Instinctively just means naturally, what comes natural. And we know that animals, they don't have a mind and a will that they can comprehend, right? The things of God. Animals just do things instinctively. And so Peter and Jude are literally saying these evil, ungodly men are operating instinctively. They're operating like it's just, they let nature take its course. They don't let God control their thinking. They just do what they feel, okay, like animals. And so, yes, it does seem a little harsh when he says it, but this is how these two apostles are speaking. They want their readers to know, you're more than animals. You're more than just people who just do things out of instinct. You have a mind. The mind belongs to God. You have a will. God controls us. We're not just mere animals. We're not just irrational beasts. We just don't operate out of what we feel and just do anything that we want. When we come to Christ, we're controlled by Christ. We're controlled by the Spirit of God. And so Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 to 3 is a reference that I'd like you to write down, because we've spoken on this before and we've referenced it before. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 to 3 describes how this instinctive behavior looks like, what it looks like. So if you turn to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 to 3, we're going to read that. And it basically says, "And you hath he made alive when you were dead, slain by your trespasses and sins." Do you remember that reference? "In which at one time you walked habitually. You were following the course and fashion of this world. You were under the sway of the tendencies of this present age, following the prince of the power of the air. You were obedient to and under the control of the demon spirit that still constantly works in the children of disobedience, the careless, the rebellious, and the unbelieving, who go against the purposes of God." And verse 3 says, "Among these, we as well as you once lived and conducted ourselves in the passions of our flesh, our behavior governed by corrupt and sensual nature." That is the natural instinct. Just nobody has to tell you to lie. You just lie. As I've said before, when a child is born and they're growing up, no one has to tell a child to lie. They don't teach a kid to lie. It's just a part of our nature, right? So we just do these things because we live in this sinful world, and our nature responds to the sinful nature around us. We are born in sin, we're shaped in iniquity, and so it's just in us to sin, right? And so what Paul was saying here is that we once lived like this, but now we are different, okay? And so we live there, we obey the impulses of our flesh, the thoughts of our mind, our cravings were dictated by our senses and our dark imaginings. We were then by nature children of God's wrath and heirs of his indignation, like the rest of mankind. And so that is the reference that I want you to look at. There are many different references, but this reference basically lets us know what Jude is saying and what Peter is saying in 2 Peter 2, verse 12, when it talks about natural, being like the animals, just doing what instinct tells us to do. But guess what? We're changed now. We're made new. We're new creatures. And so what are we going to do? We are going to follow what Jesus wants us to do. We're going to follow what the new nature that has been put in us lets us know, and lets us know what to do. And so it will come through the promptings of the Lord Jesus Christ. If we are going to behave in a certain way, we will know, no, this is not of Christ. This is not of God. God doesn't want us to do this. So this is what Jude was saying. Jude was literally saying, these people who are living this way, ungodly men, they are just operating like the animals, operating instinctively in the natural man, the natural way. And so, yes, it does seem harsh when he talks about these brute beasts and irrational animals, but that's literally what he is saying, okay? So I hope that we understand that a little bit more, okay? Not only that, he lets us know that these ungodly men, these false teachers, pretend to be spiritual, but their knowledge is only natural, right? So even what they know naturally, they use it to corrupt themselves with an unspiritual mind, okay? Now, we know animals can be smart and they can be clever in an instinctive way. Because most of us who have pets, if we have pets, you know that animals can be clever. They're instinctive about certain things. But they obviously don't have spiritual knowledge, right? Right? As much as we love our pets, as much as we enjoy being around them and they make us laugh and we have a good time and we have fun with our animals, they don't have spiritual knowledge. They don't have the capacity to have spiritual knowledge. And so when Peter and when Jude references or refers to these ungodly men as animals, it's because he's saying it's as if they don't have spiritual knowledge. And so it was the same way with these evil men. While I was doing the study, I looked at a reference from one of the theologians. His name is Michael Green. And in his commentary, he said this. And just listen, you don't have to write it down. It says, how ironic that when men should claim to be knowledgeable, they should actually be ignorant. When they think of themselves superior to the common man, they should actually be on the same level as animals and be corrupted by the very practices in which they seek liberty and self-expression. And so what that means is that we are not going to go our own way. We must go the way of the Lord. We must do what God says to do. We must go right. All right? There's another reference that we did when we studied Romans, and I'm going to give it to you again. It's Romans chapter 2, verse 21. The 22. Romans chapter 2, verse 21 and 22. And I'm just going to read it again just to refresh your memory. Romans chapter 2, verse 21 to 22. Now, I'm going to read the Amplified Bible. You may be looking at the King James, but I'm just going to read the Amplified Bible. And if you're reading along in the King James, the Amplified Bible will make it a little bit more clearer, okay? It says, because when they knew and recognized him as God, they did not honor and glorify him as God or give him thanks. But instead, they became futile and godless in their thinking, with vain imaginings, foolish reasonings, and stupid speculations. And their senseless minds were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools. Professing to be smart, they made simpletons of themselves. This is what happened when man devolved, and we spoke about that when we studied Romans. Man went lower. Man was made in the image of God. He was made to worship God. But as man, you know, grew, they decided that they want to do what they want to do, right? And so they spiraled downward. And instead of being on the level that God had created them to be, they were imagining only evil, and they did what their imagination told them to do. They didn't follow God's instructions, God's laws, and we've seen that all through Genesis, okay? We're going to look at some more verses in Genesis as we go along. And so this is why Jude spoke about this, and also Peter, who also wrote the same type of similar letter, which we had said a couple of weeks ago, that Jude may have taken some things from Peter's letter, okay? All right, so that basically explains verse 10, and now we're going to look at verse 11. I'm not sure if we're going to get through all of the examples of verse 11, but we're going to go forward and start it, okay? Let's read verse 11. Jude verse 11. Woe unto them, for they have gone in the way of Cain, and ran greedily after the error of Balaam for reward, and perished in the gainsaying of Kor. Some Bibles say Korah, okay? It's the same person. Look at the Amplified. I'm going to read, woe to them, for they have run riotously in the way of Cain, and have abandoned themselves for the sake of gain. It offers them, following the error of Balaam, and have perished in rebellion, like that of Korah. Okay. So let's talk about woe for a minute. When you see the word woe, what is it saying? It's saying certain judgment, severe judgment. Woe is pronounced upon these certain men. Okay? Woe was often used by the Old Testament prophets, such as Isaiah, Jeremiah, Micah, and Habakkuk. But Jesus used the word the most, and you'll see it throughout the Gospels of the New Testament, where Jesus used woe, pronouncing judgment on individuals and groups. Okay, we're going to just look at one Old Testament scripture, and that's taken from Isaiah chapter 3, verse 9 to 11. Isaiah chapter 3, verse 9 to 11. So woe is not something pretty. It means that there is certain judgment that is marked out for people who are not doing what they need to do. Okay? Let's turn there. Isaiah chapter 3, verse 9 to 11. We'll read that, and then I'm going to give you a New Testament scripture that Jesus used. Okay. Isaiah chapter 3, verse 9 to 11. And it says in the King James, the show of their countenance doth witness against them, and declare their sin as Sodom. They hide it not. Woe unto their soul, means judgment, for they have rewarded evil unto themselves. Say ye to the righteous that it shall be well with him, for they shall eat of the fruit of their doings. Verse 11, woe unto the wicked, it shall be ill with him, for the reward of his hands shall be given to him. So you see the contrast of woe that is pronounced upon those who do not do right, and to the righteous it says, it shall be well. That's in contrast to judgment, okay? Now, Jesus, in the New Testament reference that I'm going to give you, Luke chapter 6, verse 24 to 26. Luke chapter 6, verse 24 to 26. All right. I thought I had this one marked, but I don't have it marked, so I'm just going to find it. All right, Luke chapter 6, verse 24 to 26. This is what Jesus said.
But woe unto you that are rich, for ye have received your consolation. Woe unto you that are full, for ye shall hunger. Woe unto you that laugh now, for ye shall mourn and weep. Woe unto you when all men shall speak well of you, for so did their fathers to the false prophet. Okay, see how many times Jesus used that word woe. And that's only one chapter. I'm only giving you one chapter. But if you look at many of the chapters in the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you will find where Jesus pronounced severe judgment on those who didn't listen, who didn't obey, who were false, who displayed false religion, who were hypocrites. You know, he would often say, woe unto you hypocrites, right? So it's severe judgment. So why would Jude say this? Jude says it because he knows that his readers would understand and even feel the certain judgment declared on those who were going noticed among them, unnoticed among them, with their false teachings and their ungodly ways. They would understand it. They would understand that this is not something that is taken lightly by God. And this is why in verse 4, Jude said, for there are certain men crept in unawares who were before of old ordained to this condemnation. It means that the judgment is already marked out for those who would be disobedient, for those who would be ungodly, and who would persevere in ungodly teaching. Those who would be contaminating those in the church, okay? Their judgment is already marked out. Woe unto them. Woe unto them. So after all Jude had already stated in verse 4, and that these men have already been ordained to condemn, he is now repeating that judgment is certain by saying woe unto them. And so what does he do? After he declares that there is judgment that is pronounced on them, he does what Jude does best, as we have seen here. He gives us examples, okay? He goes ahead and he gives us some more examples. So what does he say? He says, woe unto them, for they have gone in the way of Cain and ran greedily after the error of Balaam for reward and perished in the gainsaying of Korah. So, the first example is Cain. What do we have to do? We have to go back and look at the account of Cain. So we're going to find that in our reference chapter of Genesis 4. What I'm not going to do is read the whole thing to you. What I can do is summarize it, okay? We can summarize it. I will just read a couple of verses, but we do know what happened in the story of Cain. If you don't know what happened in the story of Cain, you missed Sunday school, but you can read it, okay? And then what it says is that Genesis chapter 4, verse 3, in the process of time, Cain brought of the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord. Actually, we can actually start from verse 2. And she again bare his brother Abel. This is Adam and Eve. They conceived. They had a child. Their first son was Cain. And then she had a second son, and his name was Abel. Now, the Bible says Abel was a keeper of the sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. He was a farmer, right? And in process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought of the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord, and Abel brought also of the firstlings of his flock and the fat thereof. And the Lord had
respect unto Abel and to his offering, but unto Cain and to his offering he had not respect. And Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell. And the Lord said unto Cain, why art thou wroth, and why is thy countenance fallen? If thou doest well, shalt thou not be accepted? And if thou doest not well, sin lieth at the door, and unto thee shall be his desire, and thou shalt rule over him. So now Cain gets really angry, and what does he do? He kills his brother, okay? So what I would like you to do is just read the story. Go down and read the story. But why does he mention this when it comes to the example of these uncertain men? Because what you can gather from Cain's story, from the account of Cain, is that he brought the fruit of the ground, and it was, in essence, self-centered worship. So some people say, well, it was because he brought of the fruit of the ground was cursed, because God had cursed the ground when Adam and Eve sinned, and he cursed the ground. And some would say, well, it's because he brought of the fruit of the ground, and the ground was cursed, and Abel brought a blood sacrifice, and it's sort of like, you know, the sacrificial lamb. That might be true. That might be true, and it could be true. But one thing about it is that when you look into the book of faith, Hebrews chapter 11, verse 4, what that verse tells you is that by faith, Abel offered a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous. So it seems that it is more of a faith thing why Cain's offering was accepted. So it could be both. It could be that he brought from the ground and the ground had been cursed. But because Hebrews 11 talks about faith, and we know that without faith, it's impossible to please God, right? We know that it takes faith to come to Christ. Then faith is very, very important. But Cain brought what he thought was right, and it's called self-centered worship. He brought what he thought was right, and it was not by faith. Okay? So we must understand that these certain men are probably not worshiping God in true worship. They're doing their own thing. Okay? So true worship must be what God will receive, not merely what we want to give. It's what God will receive, just as how he received Abel's gift, Abel's sacrifice, and he rejected Cain's sacrifice. It's what God will receive, not merely what we want to give. So, you know, sometimes it lets us think about ourselves too. How am I worshiping God? Am I giving him what he requires? Am I coming to him in true worship? You know, Jesus said to the Samaritan woman, the hour cometh and now is when they that worship me must worship me in spirit and in truth. He will only accept worship that is true. He will only accept those who come to him by faith, right? And so this is important to know, that when you speak of Cain's example of worship, realize that it was not by faith. And that's why his sacrifice wasn't received. Not only that, Cain was angry. He got angry, and God spoke to him, and God corrected him. And he said, you know what? If you want to do right, you got to come again, right? God spoke to him. He said, why is your face angry? Why are you mad? Do it the right way, right? Come back the right way and I'll accept the gift, right? But Cain decided to disobey. He didn't follow what God told him to do. Instead, he seethed in hatred. He got angrier and angrier and ended up murdering his brother. Okay? So the way of Cain is the way that these certain men are following. It's in unbelief. It's not by faith. It's self-centered worship, which is empty religion. And so that's what we have to understand. When we come to God, we must come to him by faith. We must worship him in faith. It's not what we want to give him. It's what he will receive. It's what he will receive. And so it lets us put our own lives into perspective. These are what Bible study is supposed to do for us. It's supposed to let us know, am I doing what I need to do? Am I worshiping the way I ought to worship? Am I giving God what he deserves? Am I just doing it for myself? Am I just doing it selfishly? Do I have a selfish motive? Am I doing it by faith? Okay? Because the Word of God is giving us examples of how we should worship God. We don't want to go in the way of Cain. And this is what Jude was correcting the people. Jude was letting them know there are persons among you, these ungodly men who are operating in an ungodly way. And I'm giving you an example to look at, the way of Cain. All right? They're going in the way of Cain. Let me give you another reference. That reference is 2 Timothy chapter 3. Verse 5. Let's read that. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 5. And what does it say? It says, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. From such, turn away. Okay? That's just one verse, but there are four verses above it. There are four verses above it, which warns us of a certain type of people. Now, I read verse 5 so that you would see the verse. But I'm also going to read verse 1 to 4 and then read verse 5 again. This know also that in the last days, perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truth breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures, more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. From such, turn away. Now it puts it into perspective who they're talking about. Okay? It puts it, put it into perspective. This is the way of Cain. People going their own way, doing their own thing, not following after the way of the Lord, not doing what God requires, but having a form of godliness. You look like you are serving God. You look like you're doing right. We don't want to be these people. We want to be who God has called us to be. All right? Amen? And so Jude is warning. He's warning his readers. He's telling them, these uncertain men that are hiding in the church, doing their own thing, but are not really serving God. They are the ones having a form of godliness, trying to deceive others. from such people. Don't follow them. Be aware of that. Be aware of them. And so in this climate, in this time, I'm going to be ending here, because going into Korah as well as Balaam is going to take a little bit more time, and it's going to take probably longer than 15 more minutes. So I'm going to be ending here. But what we want to do is make sure that we're doing what the Word says. And this is why I want us to just be constantly rereading this book of Jude, constantly rereading the verses, understand what it's saying to us, understand how it's warning us, and also putting ourselves in the place to know that we are doing what God wants us to do. From these examples, these are examples that are giving us, you know, a warning. It's letting us know who these people were, what they have done, and the scripture is there for our example and to help us to live the life that God has called us to live. We want to go right. And when he corrects us, just like how he corrected Cain and said, you know what, if your gift wasn't accepted, maybe sin lieth at the door. Maybe you didn't come right. Maybe something was off. Try again. Cain didn't follow what God said. Cain remained rebellious and instead seethed in anger. And that anger progressed to hate. That hate progressed to murder. Okay? And so we want to do right. We want to be right. We want to be who God has called us to be. I hope that this lesson has been an example to you and has encouraged you in the Word of God to understand it even more. It seems difficult, but it's like a puzzle. We're putting the puzzle together. We're getting the answers. And soon you'll be able to explain a really difficult chapter. Okay? So may God bless you tonight. In Jesus' name.